A very good afternoon. So, every society in the world devises a set of festivals and rituals which carries multiple meaning for its members, various functional aspects, certain specific cultural markers. However, the globalizing world has blurred the boundaries of what would constitute as regional vis-a-vis international. So, I am here to talk about the history of a festival called Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī, whose name might not be familiar to most of the people sitting over here. A name which you won't find in those several books dealing with the list of festivals of India. Yet this festival is now being celebrated in several countries of the world by an expanding Gujarati diaspora, as you can see from the images. So this festival is celebrated on the day of Bhadra Shukla Ekadasi, Dashi. In this way, a festival becomes an archive for writing the history of the community it belongs to. My discussion will begin with the analysis of multiple lives and afterlives of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi. So Bhadra is the Indian month, Bhadra Shukla is the brighter half and Ekadashi is the 11th day. So this means how this sacred tithi manifested disparately in response to certain specific historical contexts of different time and space. I attempt to study this specific tithi in a longer degree, which in this case would raise some broader trends in understanding the historical emergence of various pre-modern festivals and sacred days, as well as their modern reappropriation and consolidation. I have chosen the case study of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī as I find it its most remarkably celebrated, little documented and yet largely unknown manifestation of this concerned tithi. Unlike some of the claims envisioned in the popular memory, as I will explain, the festival began to be celebrated in Gujarat only in early 19th century under certain specific social, religious and cultural contexts. Microhistory helps in understanding those events and realities that could not be adequately explained by existing macrohistorical models. In this regard, the geographical and the sacred landscape of the village Garuda in the Gujarat will act as a plot for understanding the emergence of this festival in relation to the activities of Sahajanand Swami, the leader of Swaminarayan and Bhakti Sampradaya. Lastly, I will look at how the changing context of community relations after his death consolidated the erstwhile fluid festival as evident in the emerging hagiographies, devotional verses and the new religious iconography. This study of a festival will help in understanding some larger historical trends like the emergence of religious communities and understanding the festival as a reason as well as outcome of historical memory. In contrast to historical memory, the popular memory of the members of the community traces the origin of festival from time immemorial, from a distant unknown past. Jared and Seidel in his study of Christmas mumming in Newfoundland showed that a custom that was considered to be primordial and present from the beginning in Newfoundland actually started in early 19th century in response to needs of social relations of production and time. The popular memory regarding the fairly modern festival or early modern festival of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī traces an eternal continuity from the Puranic legend in which Vishnu turns his side on this day during his 4 month sleep or as it is called Chaumasa. However, festival is perceived in this community less an innovation, that is something of 19th century, and more of a rightful adaptation of existing Pushti Margi or Vallabhpanthi liturgical practices that was common in the religious milieu of Gujarat. Thus, in this process of adaptation, these festivals were converted into Samayo by Sahajanand Swami. So, what exactly is this Samayo and who was Sahajanand Swami? So, Sahajanand Swami was undoubtedly the most charismatic spiritual figure of his time, who was believed by millions of devotees of his time and to this day as Parabrahma Purushottam, that is the supreme being who manifested or prakat on this earth to open the channels for the liberation of countless beings. His popularity in Gujarat is well recorded in contemporary Gujarati texts, but also as well as in the accounts of colonial officials, some of those who have personally shared experiences with him. So he took an active interest in reforming the spiritual practices of his time, and in this regard purifying the existing festivals out of their popular elements and then converted them into spiritual carnivals for Utsav, or more specifically Samayo in the jargon of the Sampradaya. So I began my research with the question that when exactly this Samayo of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī began to be celebrated and under what circumstances. So the ritual of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī basically involves the carrying the image of Ganesh and Thakur, that is Bhagwan Swaminarayan, in a procession and then taking it to a river body. It can be a river, pond, lake, and in modern times swimming pool, and then offerings again rituals like aartis and thal, etc., and then ritually immersing the idol of Ganesh. So, but before embarking upon the micro-historical study on the interaction of the community, that is Swamiland Sampradaya, with the landscape of village Gadeda, I intend to present, as a pretext for understanding it, a longer history of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi, the sacred tithi, as mentioned earlier, when the festival is being celebrated. Case study of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi puts light on certain broader trends, helpful in understanding the evolution of sacred tithis and festivals in subcontinent. For instance, a number of important tithis which may or may not have a Puranic or Brahmanical meaning in its earlier phase, later get wiped out of the popular meaning and got a more dominant Brahmanical meaning. So, for instance, festivals like Vasantotsav mentioned in Ratnavali for the adoration of Kama, it got a more Brahmanical meaning. Similarly, the Indradhanuja Chayan festival linked to the kingship became Radhashtami in medieval times. And also, additionally, a festival may have an innate or inner Vaishnav meaning, as in the case of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi, but that meaning interacted with different historical conjunctures and produced a different historical results. Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi, or Parivartani Ekadashi, as it is called after the Puranic legend of Vishnusri, was one of the 24 Ekadashis that Vaishnav should observe each year. However, this Parivartani Ekadashi appears to have been far less important there than Devuttapani and Devshani, that means when Vishnu was put on sleep and Vishnu is Vishnu awakens. So, you know, in the text dealing with the festival, this scaling is evident in those texts dealing with the treatment of festivals in Purana, in inscriptions, etc. For instance, Himatri treatise on 700 contemporary Vratanotsav mentioned other two Ekadashi but does not mention the Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi or Parivartani Ekadashi. Rather, it mentions Bhadra Shukla Dwadashi as Chakra Uttanotsav, that means day on which Indra awakens and not Vishnu. Bhagavad has shown that Vratanotsav acquired a bigger role in the religious culture of the people of North and Central India during the early medieval period due to increasing land grants and ritualism. In this regard, Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi appears for the first time in the early medieval inscriptions as a meritorious and recurring day for donations, but does not suggest any connection with that Puranic Parivartini legend. So, in this way, Puranic legend gave one identity to the concerned tithi, but not a strong enough to give rise to any festival, in the case of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī per se. Moreover, since the month of Bhadrapad falls on in the rainy season, several water-related festivals historically emerge in different regions, and the emergence of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī was part of this trend. But P.V. Kane's comprehensive list of more than 1200 vrats and utsav, it lacks any specific water-related festival that would have fallen on this day, or even a festival in which there would have been a ritual of boat ride that would fall in the month of Bhadrapad. So Panchrat text does mention festivals like Jalpida utsav, Toyotsav, Lavotsav, Udotsav, so all are related with some kind of water rituals, but these are not celebrated in the month of Bhadrapad. Similarly, several prominent temples, Vaishnav temples like the Ranchodrai, the Pushti Margi Havelis, all those modern ISKCON temples, temples of Mathura, Odisha, Tirupati, so all of them have some kind of water rituals in which the deity is given a boat ride, but nothing is celebrated in the month of Bhadrapad. That makes the case of emergence of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī in the region of Gujarat something very specific. There is only one instance where I could found a namesake of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī in the region of Rajsamand, Charbhuja Mandir of Rajsamand. So they call it Jaḷa-Jhulaṇī, not Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī. But interestingly, the more popular name of this is Dol Utsav. This festival was an adaptation of those influences of the Pushti Margi Dwara to the landscape of Ghatkopar village and to the social needs of the Gujar community of the village. And a festival was developed in this village, and later they adopted this name of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī for Dol Agyaras and named it Jaḷa-Jhulaṇī. Francis Mallison showed that Pushti Margi became widely popular in the well-to-do classes of Gujarat from the first part of the 16th century, and later it deeply influenced the Swaminarayan liturgies and ritualistic devotion. In the Pushti tradition of little later period, the concerned tithi acquired a new meaning as Dal Leela or Dalotsav, clearly independent of that Parivartini. So in that new created legend, the Vishnu is not important, but the new legend is that the Krishna, because those gopis are going to offer the butter, and instead of giving to Kansa, they give butter as a dan to Krishna, so they celebrated Dalotsav. So it was a Pushti market that raised the position of Bahadur Shukla Ekadashi from his humble precedence in the western India, and Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī was built upon the explorations of this space. A clear narrative for the emergence of this festival during the life of Sahajanand Swami comes from the several hagiographies that were composed during his lifetime and after his death. So in these texts, festivals provide a frame of locating and understanding the notion of time. We know that the pre-modern notions of time was different from the capitalist notion of fixed quantified time. French sociologist Roger Calvez remarked that in the traditional society, men lived in the remembrance of one festival and in the expectation of the next. Thus, these hagiographies chronologically enumerated the life events of Sahajanand Swami as records of what important had happened in between two major festivals, which were those periods of intense activities in a very chronological manner. That makes those days important for historians. Thus, festivals become an important marker for understanding the history of fellowship from its earliest time. Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī emerged as a festival in phases and was gradually consolidated in the form as we see today. In the village of Gadda, where Sahajanand Swami spent most of his life and which was a core of his satsang activities, it was perhaps the landscape of Gadda, marked by the river Jaḷa, that provided base and impetus for the emergence of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī festival. Or what can be said as the reorientation of already prevalent sacred tithi of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi under this Pushtimal influence. Festival became a day for intense spiritual devotion as well as building the bond of devotees with the manifest God and also with the other devotees of fellowship in the emerging community. Records suggest that during his first decade of stay in Gujarat, he observed Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi just like any other tithi that would simply involve fasting and other things, but not as a celebration of Vishnu's turn in his sleep. Gradually, the position of this tithi elevated from its humble practices. Somewhat around second decade of this day, that is around 1810, it emerged as one of the special days in which certain informal water-related activities like procession to a river body and then jal krida that were carried on. It was later that these water activities get to be associated with Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi from something of a very general practice to of something very specifically attached to Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī. This shift happened in Gadda quite lately, something around the third decade of his stay, when the practice of giving boat ride to the image of Balmukul means Krishna, started. Moreover, it was only from the accounts of his last Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī celebration of the year 1829, where one finds the first specific reference of boat ride to Sahajanand Swami on this day. It was in the period after his death, or as it is called Swadham Gaman in the Sampradaya Jagan, of Sahajanand Swami, that those fluent rituals of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī became fully consolidated amidst the situation of Sampradaya when the Lord was no longer physically present. It was the remembrance, or as it is called Smriti, of those regular water plays of Sahajanand Swami that converted a habitual practice into a ritual within his lifetime, and it became even more popular after his death when devotees' remembrance of Smriti of those prasanga they had with their Lord in Jaḷa River and also in other water bodies gave impetus to the celebration of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī. So by giving boat ride to Jalmurti of Sahajanand Swami, devotees would not only perform their devotion through the ritual, but also remember those divine experiences. The historical memory occupied a major space in the emerging hagiographies, wherein virtually every hagiography devotes a section in the glorification of river Jaḷa, and even later there emerged texts like Unmat Ganga Mahatmya. So the river Ganga was Jaḷa was compared with Ganga as Unmat Ganga Mahatmya for the river. Similarly, Durpur Mahatmya, something around 1899, meant for the glorification of the village Gadda. Moreover, as the Sampradaya expanded and the Purushottam Padma of Sahajanand Swami became increasingly accepted, that means more and more people started believing Sahajanand Swami as Purushottam, so there was shift in the identity of the deity to be given forthright. It shifted from Thakurji to Thakurji, from earlier Thakurji meaning the Chalmurti of Krishna Balmukul to Sahajanand Swami. So there was an innovation in iconography as well as in the kirtan, because they wanted a new iconography that would be distinct from those previous Pushti Margi iconography. So this kind of image which you see of Balmugund in the Pushtimarga, the modern Krishna liturgies, they wanted something distinct from this. So they adopted this kind of iconography. Now it has some and for that they get inspiration from those medieval bronze images of North India. So for example, that area. So it was modified into this image because they wanted some distinction. And I have showed that image because those liturgical practices of Pushtimarga were adopted. So they had a continuity as well as a distinction in this case. Now, I'll talk this change in terms of the kirtans. This ship was visible in the reorientation of certain layered meaning in the Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī kirtans. While those composed in the time of Sahajanand Swami, Vahins Paramahans, all these ordained monks like the Muktanand Swami, Brahmanand Swami, Premanand Swami, extolled him in a way in which writer was directly witnessing the event. On the other hand, those composed after his death, like the kirtans by Achintyanand Brahmachari, Krishnanand Swami, they seem to be dedicated to the bronze image of the Lord meant for the Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī kirtan. Term Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī itself appears to have become used either quite lately during his lifetime or after his death and became popular later. So careful analysis of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī kirtan would reveal their multivariant nature and how they operate at different levels and produce different meanings in relation to specific circumstances. Kirtans and other form of devotional verses not only served as medium for Paramahans to express their deep devotion for Sahajanand Swami, but also to share his identity as manifest supreme in front of masses. But how did they do it? So he was believed to be a great persona by millions of the people of his time, but their notion of his real identity varied. So for some he was Parabrahma Purushottam, reason for all avatars. Others considered him to be just like another avatar. Some considered him to be Krishna himself who has come, or some kind of divine figure. So in such a scenario of acceptance and adjustment, Paramahans made a frequent use of what I call as the Krishna metaphor as a tool in kirtans and hagiographies, in which Sahajanand Swami is frequently compared with Krishna, but at the same time subtly and gradually revealing the supremeness of former. Comparison with Krishna offered a way to establish a legitimate spiritual continuity with the previous Vaishnava orders. Or elsewhere, this Krishna motif may simply act as a poetic motif for devotional emotions or aesthetics. Moreover, when Paramahans attempted to describe the glory of the manifest Lord, personally manifest Lord for Pratyaksh, but in the existing language of devotion of Krishna Bhakti, that is Parosh Bhakti, it would have evoked different level of meaning for different audiences. So it would have a denotative meaning of a primary or a denotative meaning for certain section of devotees who would assume that the devotion for Krishna is explicitly talked about. At a further level, the same kirtan would gain a connotative meaning for a different set of devotees who would understand that through these kirtan and through the worship of Krishna, they are actually pleasing Sahajanand Swami. Then kirtan works at even more deeper level and offers a vyanjit. Vyanjit is ancient people might have been familiar with the word vyanjit or tertiary meaning. Through describing the glory of Krishna, those who realize Sahajanand Swami is Parabrahma Purushottam, who is over and above all, including the Krishna, transmute their devotion to the manifest Lord. So these three meanings operate simultaneously at different level based on the level of understanding and realization for it. So I hope I'll conclude because of shortage time, I will just show one kirtan and then I will just conclude. So this kirtan is composed, this is the Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī kirtan composed by Muktanand Swami. Nav chade dhan nandan, navalpiya nav chade dhan nandan, shobha dham rasit dhan nandan, nirghat kot anand. Bhadra shukle ekadashi ke din, yamna janmahi shyam, nav baithe tadhi dhan chukavat, suknidhi shobha dham. Sakhajan man haran shamro, jad madhye karat vihar, Muktanand nath aksharpati, akhil bhuvan adhar. So in this kirtan, the protagonist of the celebration is Lord, is this Lord, that is Dharmananda or Sahajanand Swami, but the spirituality is ambiguous. So reference here is not of Jaḷa river or any other river that can be associated with Sahajanand Swami, but Yamuna associated with Krishna. What is even more interesting is the appropriation of the Dhan Leela legend of Pushtimarga, the use of Vardhadi Dhan, in the Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī kirtan. So by doing so, Muktanand Swami carefully places Sahajanand Swami in place of Krishna and his Haribhakta or his devotees as gopis or so, but at the end he again emphasized on the supremeness of Sahajanand Swami by using terms like aksharpati, which are among those philosophical terms meant for the supreme being. And similar groups, several similar groups are placed. For example, in some cases it may have been that Sahajana Swami is having boat ride in Yamuna, and it is the Gokul, it is the Kailas, it is the people of Gadada there that are watching those all things, and several similar kind of experiments. He may play, those Paramahans may play with the name of the, so Shyam is Krishna, and Shyam is Sahajana Swami, Shyam Jilava, then Shyam Jilava, Shyam Padharya, then Shyam Padharya. So, so it was just not repetition of or a rhyming, but it served a purpose of a deliberate comparison. So this kind of ambiguity or the use of Krishna metaphor, this declined after the death of Sahajana Swami, when it was clear that these kirtan were specifically and directly meant for Sahajana Swami. So I am just concluding, the inner traditional meaning of Bhadra Shukla Ekadashi interacted with different social, religious and regional settings. This not only resulted in an early dissociation with Indra's awakening, but more importantly, historical emergence of several festivals on this day in different regions, Dal Leela, Dal Utsav, Dola Gyaras, Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī, Jaḷa-Jhulī, Purushottam Yatra, and a new rejuvenated form of Parivartini Ekadashi. These were not just different names of the same sacred tithi, but had different meanings that were deeply contextualized to the social setting in which they were evolved, named, and reappropriated. I have attempted to dissociate Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī from his popular memory in favor of a historical memory of Smriti. Emergence of festivals like Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī cannot be explained with broader trends of microhistorical history, but with micro-methodological specificities. One should note that this was just one of those important festivals associated with Sampradaya, but the case study of Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī would help in understanding the role of festivals or Samayo in the emergence and spread of community. Later, the additional layers of meaning began to be associated with festival in the 20th century when various subsects emerged based on the interpretation of philosophy. However, for the devotees, these historical precedents are least important. Rather, each layer provides them a spiritual understanding. For example, discourses emphasize upon the popular memory of Parivartini legend to preach Parivartan or transformation in the life. Lastly, Jaḷa-Jhilaṇī provides a chance to give a boat ride to those. Those means Guru and the Rona Sangha or Sahajana Swami as it is called, who are Bhavjal Tarika, that would mean to ferry the Lord and then to cross the oceans of Saṃsāra. Thank you.